Take a person, take a story, take you on a journey. It's your take.
Hello and welcome to Your Take, the interview YouTube channel. And I'm your host, James Ewen. Thank you for watching and have a look at all our interviews with people talking about their lives, their careers, their journey, all through their perspective. Subscribe to the channel and enjoy this episode of Your Take. On today's Your Take, I'm joined by a renowned musician who's been playing piano since she was a child. By the age of five, my guest had received a full scholarship to the Guildhall School of Music and Drama. She is the youngest person to attend and major in both cello and piano. My guest was performing to audiences from the age of four. She went on to further her musical studies at the Trinity, Laban Conservatoire of Music and Dance in Greenwich, London, before venturing to the US for a master's degree at the Manhattan School of Music. In her musical career, she has performed at several festivals and all over the globe, been acclaimed as the UK's top pianist and top three instrumentalists for the TV programme Britain's Brilliant Prodigies, released her debut album Heaven and Hell, The Doors of Perception in 2018, received the British Empire Medal in 2022 for her services to the community in West London, where she played around 250 consecutive concerts during the UK lockdown. On today's Your Take, we take you on a musical journey and hear Harriet Stubbs' incredible story. From her roots, performing from a young age, her musical passion, and becoming renowned on the world stage. Thank you kindly for joining me on today's Your Take. From that introduction alone, there's a lot to tap into and to talk about your musical passion and playing music from such a young age. Before we do so, I want to rewind and go back to the very beginnings and find out about your upbringing and your early life and where this love of music, where it comes from. Can we begin by, can you tell us when and where you were born and where you grew up? And what are your recollections of your childhood? And can you give us an insight into the things that captured your imagination as a small child?
Yeah, I was born in Eastbourne in East Sussex. And I lived in different parts of Sussex. We moved quite a lot until I was about 12. And then I moved to London and then I moved to New York after that. I don't remember learning the piano or starting to learn it. I was just too young. So I don't really know exactly how that came to be. But I was performing very young, and I think as a teenager, I really developed my own reasons for wanting to do it rather than it just being something which had happened before I even really knew it was happening.
You've told us when and where you were born and a bit about the logistics of places you've lived. I want to come on and talk about your parents and find out who they are and what they did in terms of their careers. And do you have any older or younger siblings?
My father is an estate agent and my mother was a piano teacher. And I have a younger brother who's 5.5 years younger than me, and he is an actor and lives in LA.
You've spoken about music from a very young age, but obviously your mum was a music teacher, but did you come from a musical family, and was music played around the household, and what styles and forms of music inspired you from a young age, and what do you think attracted you to performing music from such a young age?
My father had a really wide variety of music that he enjoyed listening to. And after marrying my mother, became very deeply interested in classical music and had a huge volume of it and understanding. And to this day means that we can talk about music in a really exciting way, which is wonderful given that he doesn't have any background in it. But he also loved rock and roll and listened to a lot of it, and that was always around in the house. So I'm sure that that influenced what I ended up doing later in life. And it was really going to Glastonbury and hearing the Verve live that I really decided that I wanted to do it as my chosen career for the rest of my life. You know, as a young child, I was doing it. I had concerts booked long before I even really knew what that meant in many ways. You know, I turned up and I did what I was supposed to do, and I was chauffeured around to do them. But when I was questioning, you know, going through the transition from a child artist to an adult artist and what that was going to be like and what I really wanted to do in my life, I had so many things that I loved and so many things that I was interested in. But the sort of chasm without music was too great to be filled by anything else. And so it really was clear that music was going to be what I did for the rest of my life.
It's an incredible story, because you start playing piano from the age of three and you perform publicly a year later. But did playing music come naturally? And would you say your parents were a driving force in helping you pursue a musical career from such a young age?
Yes, I think that they made a lot of sacrifices to make it possible for me to do it, and were very invested in that being my future.
I want to come on to schooling. Can we discuss your schooling and how at the age of five you received a scholarship to the Guildhall School of Music and Drama? And I also wanted to ask you about being the youngest pupil ever to attend and going on to major in both cello and piano, completing a grade A distinction in both at just the age of eight.
So I was at Junior Guildhall from 5 until 15, but that was on Saturdays, and then I would do regular schooling during the week. It was always a sort of balance between trying to keep a normal academic life afloat and a sort of full-time concert career and Saturdays at Guildhall. But Guildhall is always my favourite part of the week. All my friends were a lot older than me, and I became used to that being the dynamic, but it was actually really fun. And I really enjoy my time there, and had a great time.
It's interesting because you excel in music at a young age, but I want to ask you, in terms of your academia, were you a natural academic and did you enjoy your schooling, and were there any subjects that particularly interested you that you maybe thought, well, if the music thing doesn't work out, maybe I might pursue a career in another area?
Yeah. So I was 2 years ahead academically at school as well, initially, as I was sort of being accepted into Guildhall. But it wasn't possible to be exceptional at one thing and try and do everything else to that level as well. But I really kind of got the opportunity to explore from sort of the age of 15 onwards, and really even until today, all the other things that I have interest in and love. You know, I love philosophy, I love literature. I've developed a recent love of languages. I'm also a dive master and a free diver. And I never really had the opportunity to participate in sports at school, because it was one of the things that kind of got taken off my curriculum to enable me to go and do music, but discovered as an adult how much I love that aspect of my life, and sort of contribute to science data research. So all of those things I love and actually contribute to my music, really.
Harriet, during your time at Guildhall, you're mixing with like-minded people, older musicians, accomplished musicians. What do you think you learnt from your time at music school, and what do you ultimately feel you learned about music performance from your peers and your fellow students?
So Guildhall gave me so many performing opportunities, which is really important because performing is a practice in itself outside of the practice of practicing your instrument. And they were always very generous in the amount of time that they gave me to do that. My teacher at Guildhall, Jimmy Gibb, was exceptional and didn't teach children. So to take me on was quite special and I suppose a risk for him. But he taught me all the foundations of my technique and gave me such a high level to aspire to. And even after I'd left Guildhall and long into my adult life, until he died, I would go and visit him and we'd play together. And he came to my graduation recital. And even when he had Alzheimer's and couldn't remember what he'd had for lunch, he could still play Mozart from memory with me. It's just extraordinary.
Leads on nicely to my next question, because you've mentioned Jimmy Gibb as a teacher, and you've gone on record to cite many teachers and people in music that have been a huge influence on you. Can we dig a bit deeper and just discuss your relationship with Jimmy and his methods of teaching music? And can we also discuss some of the other influential people, such as composer Douglas Finch and John Baccano, from your studies in New York?
Yes. So after I'd finished teaching with Jimmy, I was with Ronan O'Hora for a couple of years, who was the head of piano at Guildhall. And then I studied briefly with Joan Havel, but the next teacher that I really had a long-standing relationship with and still do today is Douglas Finch, who was my piano teacher at Trinity, but is still the person that I go and play to when I have a new set of rep and about to go and do concerts. And he is always and still is a huge support to me. In terms of principal study teachers at Manhattan School of Music, I never really had a bond with them in the way that I had with Douglas and with Jimmy, but Dr. Pagano was my humanities teacher. So in US degrees, you also do other subjects as well. And he reignited my love of William Blake. And he had this very cool course called Genius and Madness. And it was like Jim Morrison and Virginia Woolf, couple with Blake. And it was my favorite part of the whole master's degree. And I was always away doing concerts, but I was always kind of submitting free writes. And to this day, we're still in touch, you know, on a sort of monthly basis. He was just such an inspiring person in my life and is really the reason that Heaven and Hell ended up being my debut album when I was deciding what the piece of work that was going to define my future as a kind of adult artist. It was that influence that really pulled all those things together for me. So
from your academia, we come on to performing to live audiences, which you've been doing from a young age, which we've already established, performing at major music festivals here in the UK and all over the globe. What do you think you've learned musically and professionally from being exposed to performing to an audience from a young age? And does live performance excite you the most?
It does. It definitely does. I am constantly relearning how to perform. You know, when I was little, I never had to think about it. In a way, I was prepared and I walked on stage and it all worked. And then as you get older, you have experiences. You know, we have experiences of the moment that we didn't feel so good or that something wasn't perfect. And those experiences and the experience of just getting older mean that you retrain your psyche each time to be at its best to go on rather than it just being there and in the right space. And what I mean by that is, with all the preparation in the world, you can never fully predict how you're going to feel on the day, or in which part, whether it's just before you go on stage or whilst you're on stage, or that you're going to feel that adrenaline and how you harness it, and also how it impacts your memory and your relationship with memory and performing from memory in public. And all of that becomes a constant working relationship with yourself and with your art to be your best every time you go on, because the adrenaline's there to make you your best, right? If there was no adrenaline, then it wouldn't be exciting. But it's about learning to utilize it as you evolve.
From live performance, I want to come a bit back to your musical training, because you've spoken about your scholarship and time at Guildhall. Can we come on and talk about your experiences studying at Trinity Laban Conservatoire of Music and Dance, and also talk about what made you decide to move to New York to study for a master's degree at the Manhattan School of Music?
Trinity for pianists is such a gift, because the facilities are really incomparable. You know, you can always get a practice room whenever you need one. You're overlooking the river. They're gorgeous rooms. And, you know, most music conservatoires are really practice rooms with no windows that you can barely, you know, get them at the time that you need them. And, you know, the impact of being in that environment, I think, is extremely healthy. And all the pianos were so well looked after, which again, doesn't happen everywhere. So I really felt that the students came first there, and I still feel that that is the case, and that I was really nurtured. And the reason that I chose to go to the US was because I'd had a child career. I had really been working by that time for 18 years full time in my industry. Everybody knew who I was, and I knew the circuit pretty well. And so if I was going to invest the time and money in a master's degree, I wanted to be doing it somewhere where I wasn't known and to learn a new culture. Although I have to say, at the time, I really underestimated how different US culture would be to UK culture. And I learned so much more than I could possibly imagine. And it's really added to my life. But, you know, you think, well, it's the same language. How different can it be? It's very, very different. And so that was really why I wanted to go to New York. And also, since I was very little, I'd just kind of made this decision I was going to be in New York for no apparent reason. And then when I got there, I realized what the reason was, and that was really going to be home for me.
I want to talk about culture, because interestingly, you spent the majority of your life living in the capital, London. And to me, being alien, living in a much smaller city, to me, London is a very fast-paced lifestyle. But I wanted to talk about New York and the comparisons, because how did you manage to adapt to this New York lifestyle? And what would you cite as the cultural differences? And did you miss life back here in London and in the UK?
I think when I first got there, I was a very different person to the person I am today. So, you know, I loved my life in London. I wasn't leaving London because I was unhappy. I was leaving it on a high, you know, ready to take on the next adventure. And so probably the first couple of years, and being in a master's degree and living up there in Harlem and wondering what I'd done, you know, because I'd left perfectly happy life to go and do something else in a much tougher environment. You know, it just doesn't have the same security that the UK has, you know, education, healthcare, the disparity between poverty and wealth, even the harsher winters, all of it, it's all just a bit tougher. But then every year that I put in, everything just got better and better and better. And by year 5 or 6, I couldn't imagine being anywhere else. And the sort of progress trajectory from the beginning and how it had pushed me to evolve to be my best, and it always expects me at my best, brought out the best in me. But London provides, you know, the green spaces in London are amazing, and the stability here, and my friends here too. But I think that I just responded to that high energy, high extreme environment, and also this that can do attitude and of opportunity rather than why something can't happen is always about how can we make it possible. It is possible. How can we do it? And I think that's been a great addition to my life, actually.
It's interesting that you mention opportunity, because if we take music and we look back at British musical history, we're steep with incredible success. You go back, take one example, to the 60s and the British invasion, us kind of taking music back to America with the obvious people like the Beatles, the Stones, and all those bands at the time. But we all kind of buy into this American dream. And again, music in America has been so influential from all different aspects and genres. But do you think being exposed to that gives you as a musician more opportunity in America in some ways? Obviously, it's a bigger industry and a bigger commercial market. But do you think just being there gave you more opportunities in a way?
Gave me many more opportunities, and also because of the Musicians Union partially, and partially because there's a philanthropic model in place in the US and there's a state-funded model in place in Europe, and UK falls in between the two and doesn't really quite do either. UK musicians are paid a third of what US musicians are paid, so we don't really value our musicians in the same way here. And the other part of it is that the US touring model is much easier, because you just have a tour bus, or you can fly, but it's easier to manage than now, especially after the European referendum, where visas are impossible for UK musicians trying to work in the EU, and the same for them, where the US is really one of our last viable markets. And also because I didn't really want to do a continuation of what I've been doing in the UK before I moved to the US, which was performing in straight classical music venues, classical music. I wanted to do something much bigger with a capacity for a much larger audience and to reach spaces that classical music had never been before. The US had the open-mindedness to accept and embrace that a long time before the UK did.
You had this outstanding musical education. You're also exposed to another culture in the USA. I want to talk about other experiences and exposure you've had in film, television, and radio, and ask you, how did you get the role to appear and perform in Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban? And then I want to come on to some of your early television exposure as well.
Well, happened because I was with the Sylvia Young agency as a sort of pre-teenager, and my brother was at Sylvia Young as an actor, and I'd been seen on Britain's Brilliant Prodigies, and so they approached Sylvia Young and asked if I would go and be in this role. And it was the coolest, you know, few weeks, because I got to leave school and be like, sorry, I'm on set for Harry Potter. Like, what? So it was great, yeah.
What was the atmosphere like on the set?
It was really fun. It was really, really fun. One of my sort of happiest working memories as a child, I think, because you're just surrounded by other people that are there and so excited and doing this really cool thing, and they looked after us so well. It was amazing. We used to try and sneak makeup on the bus on the way there, and then we'd get there and the makeup artist would take it off. They think that, you know, we thought that we were so subtle about it, and we weren't. We were 13, you know. But it was really fun.
You were talent spotted for that role. For your exposure on Britain's Brilliant Prodigies, which you mentioned. Can you discuss your time on that television programme? And second to that, what was it like being named one of the top three pianists in Britain by Julian Lloyd Webber?
That competition was at a really... exciting and strange time. You know, I was 12, so I was coming out of being a child, coming into being a teenager. And, you know, at the end of the child prodigy age and about to go through this transition. And so the competition at the time was full of children that were younger and older. You know, Nikki Benedetti was one of the other instrumental finalists. And she was a little bit older than me. But then there were those that were much younger. And it was this question of repertoire, you know, what was going to be chosen? Because, you know, would Bach be accepted in the same way that, you know, Rachmaninoff would sound, would impress a television audience more? And was I going to stand by who I wanted to be as an adult or what I was as a child? And I remember that sort of process and those conversations quite well. And then I remember going to perform it live and how exciting that was. And I was amazed that I got, you know, to where I got. It was a wonderful time.
Do you think that opportunity and winning that prestige and from peers and colleagues and people very established in classical music, do you think that opened more doors?
Yes. Yes, I do. I think that I, at the time, I was about to find out really why I wanted to do music and what I was going to do with it. So I was just on the threshold of kind of discovering my identity and what I wanted to do with music. And so perhaps it happened, but where it was going to, you know, had I been seven, then it would have been five more years of child prodigy. But that age, it was just like Nikki, actually, both of us were at that kind of stage where we were going, okay, what's happening next? So yes, I do. But everything that I did after that was quite different for quite a long time as I sort of found who I was going to be as an adult professionally and what the repertoire and performance spaces and message and everything around it that I wanted to do were going to look like.
It's interesting you mentioned this transition from child musician to adult. And obviously throughout life, we change depending on events and circumstances that happen in our lives. Do you think there's less pressure as a child because you're not exposed to other things and you've not matured yet? You've not gone through certain things that most of us do, like marriage, children, outside factors. Do you think it's easier in a way?
I think it's a strange blessing and curse combined. You know, it's there's the pressure of the talent, which I suppose our parents or caregivers carry for a long time, that we can't really comprehend as children. And then as we start to feel the burden of it as we become older and about to take it on ourselves, in some ways I know that I felt much older than the age that I was, because I was expected to turn up with the professionalism of an adult and be able to socialize in adult settings all the time. And so in a way I felt, oh well, like I've far accelerated, I've got it, I'm there, you know, it's all sorted. And then, but without any of the skills that are developed through age, time on the planet, and also normal life. So you've got this really disparate set of circumstances. And then what we do with those really define, you know, how talent is then transitioned from child to adult. And, you know, it's sometimes very successful and sometimes isn't, sadly, because it's such a difficult terrain to navigate for both parents and the child and the teenager.
It's really interesting what you're saying, and you're kind of exposed, as you say, to adults and you're constantly in adult company. Were there times where you felt it really hard to relate to people of your age group? And also, were there times where you just wanted to go off and just do things that your average child would do at that age?
Yes. I've always been used to my life being very different from my immediate age group until I was sort of a teenager and tried to learn what that was all about, but whilst also giving concerts. And I think yes, I think that I needed the space in my sort of mid-teenage years to find out where I was going to sit as a human being before I could push myself back out into life as a professional musician. I had to have something to give. I had to have something to say and to develop the skills to, you know, navigate life around it too, rather than just the skills to perform concerts and all the things that go with that. But I've more than done that and taken that to such sort of extremes that I feel that it's all sort of married up now and just get to do all of the things at their highest, which is fun.
Harry, I want to change course slightly, because you've already cited earlier some of the people that taught you that were huge influences on your musical life and career. I want to come on to musicians and ask you, who are your favourites and why? And are there any musicians or composers, past or present, you'd like to collaborate with, and for what reasons?
I mean, favourite musicians, I could go on forever. I mean, classically, I love Prokofiev and I love Beethoven. I love Rachmaninoff. I mean, you know, it depends who I am in that day and also what I'm working on at that time. And but Prokofiev, I think, has always stuck as my sort of dearest love, at least for the last 15 years. But then, you know, outside of classical music, I loved very much David Bowie. That's how I ended up being involved in that world in the way that I did. I love Martha Argerich, the pianist. I love, who would I want to work with that I haven't already? I would love actually to get to play for Martha and do something with her one day. I know that she's not necessarily performing in the way that she was, but that would be wonderful. If David Bowie could come back, that'd be very cool. And you know, the collaborations in the new album that is going out in September very much sort of covers that broad spectrum of musicians as well.
You've played and performed many styles of music. Which would you say you feel most comfortable playing and why? And are there any music forms you've not performed that you would like to explore and experiment with?
Yes, I think that it's, I think I would like to really develop my improvisational skills. I've kind of had a taste over the last few years of doing that in rock and roll settings. And there's a huge amount of freedom and fun and contrast to the discipline required within the classical framework or even within a given score. And I really enjoyed learning that very different set of skills, and I'd like to expand them further. And that in itself opens up so many more genres of music and avenues to explore and skills to harness. And I think, you know, I feel very comfortable in music that has integrity, right? And so if I believe in the thing that I'm a part of playing, then I'm doing it because I deeply believe in it and feel comfortable in it. But that doesn't mean that I don't want to try new things, and I think improvisation is one of them.
I've asked this same question to several musicians that I've interviewed on Your Take, most of which are singer-songwriters that tend to work with lyrics. But I wanted to come on to composition. And do you like to compose your own music? And how does that process work for you? And do you feel comfortable just coming up with your own original ideas and writing music and sitting down and actually recording that? How does that kind of creative process work for you?
Well, in terms of words, I do write. So I just published a piece for the Blake Society on invisible women in Blakean mythology, which sounds unrelated, but it all informs what I end up doing musically. And so I get to write, which is to me a creative process and does help my music. And I don't see any reason why that wouldn't necessarily be able to coexist with writing music. I've just done really my first public composing, performing on James Stevenson of The Alarm and Jean Loves Jezebel, writing the piano parts for that and then performing them. And that was definitely out of my comfort zone when he first asked me to do it. And then having gone outside of my comfort zone and done it, it's emboldened me and excited me to do more. So, yeah.
It's interesting. I want to pick up on literature because I get this sense that you've got a love for writing and great literature. Does that play kind of an integral role in music? Because music is about, it can be about telling a story in whatever form. And some of the best songwriters and musicians are what I would say are great storytellers. Would you say that literature's played a huge impact in communicating music?
Absolutely. And the way that I teach, I only have a few students and they kind of accept a remote lifestyle because they'll mostly have it online when I'm traveling, but yeah, I see them when I see them. But my teaching includes the history and philosophy and literature of the time of the composers that they're learning. Like, I don't just give them a piano lesson. They have this whole sort of much broader curriculum if they're going to study with me, because I understand the need to just have applied teaching, but if there's no understanding of what the relevance is, it's very difficult to ask people to be permanently excited about doing it when it can be, it would take quite a long time and requires a lot of patience. But if the bigger picture is being given all the time, I think that that makes it easier to want to carry on rather than saying, well, you just need to understand this part. So accomplish this and then we'll talk about the next bit, you know.
I want to come on to a different chapter in your life, and we all have different perspectives in regard to the lockdown here in the UK during the global pandemic. Can you share with us your recollections from the UK lockdown, and what made you decide to give daily concerts from your London home? And can you discuss the reaction and performing around 250, incredible number, over that period?
Yeah, I so I just come in from San Diego. I'd been to the Grammys in LA, had no idea it was going to be the last one for a long time. And I thought, oh, I'm just going to go into London, give a concert, and then that's it. And then I flew in and the borders closed. I thought, well, it'll be a few weeks, it's fine, just enjoy being in London. And but you know, soon became apparent that it was going to be a while. And I think the first month was just, it was so out of all of our control, you know, and so everything felt a little bit pointless that I could offer. It's like, well, I'm not a medic. What can I actually do that's useful for people and also, you know, for myself? And I think I decided that one of the things that I missed most about life pre-pandemic at that time was routine, because even though I travel extensively, I'm very disciplined about my routine, and I missed certain things happening at certain times of the day that I could implement that I could no longer do. So I thought, what if there was something that happened at exactly the same time every single day that people could enjoy, and everyone was allowed to leave the house for an hour's exercise a day, right? And I decided to make it at 5 o'clock, where they would, you know, during when schools were open, getting them from school, or it seemed like the kind of the right time of day to do it. And I would have people that listened outside my window anyway, when I would come back to London to learn new rep in the summer. So I thought I would invite them instead of having it closed and just open it at that time and see what happened. And gradually more and more people started to come. So then I started to advertise it, because it was clear that people were really enjoying having somewhere to go and something that they knew was going to happen every day. When I committed to every day, I didn't think it would be 250. I did think that it was going to be probably, you know, 30. But that's what I committed to. So I carried on.
It's incredible when you mentioned about routine, but I kind of want to tap into the psychology of the lockdown, because I feel very selfish. For me, the lockdown was an extraordinary period of my life, and I kind of feel it was one of the best things to happen. I say that very selfishly. And from a musician's point of view, someone who's very, very creative, do you think it sparked that creativity more? The fact that you had this routine, you're exposing your music to people that may have not heard it before, and did it kind of just give you a buzz and a drive creatively, and, you know, a personal drive as well?
Yes. I mean, it was that or not want to practice eventually, because when you have no concerts in sight with a sort of horizonless future, eventually you're not going to feel like practicing, right? So it kept me both practicing and learning new rep all the time. It also made me internalize the repertoire for the new album and give me opportunities to perform some of it. It also gave me a social interaction with other people, be it through a window at first. And then when people got vaccinated, I started to take drinks outside. But before that, it was, you know, hello through the window. And I also used the time as well. You know, I would say that although it paused my career in many ways, it also enabled me to do so many things that I hadn't had the chance to do yet. I trained to swim the channel. I became a free diver during that time. I got my driving license during that time. And I actually timed the 200th concert to be the same week as my driving test, because I had to have a surgery. I needed to make sure all of them had happened before the lockdown would reopen. So it all kind of timed in at the same time. So I made it work.
I think we as people are all going to take away different things regarding on our set of circumstances with regard to the lockdown. But this is quite a deep question. But personally, what do you think you took away from it altogether, you know, in terms of, you know, do you think life became less fast paced? Do you think it was a case sometimes where we take things for granted, that we can actually look back and think, well, actually, we're lucky that we've got these things in our lives? Or, you know, just like to hear kind of your take on the whole kind of situation.
Yeah, I definitely think that it made me value what I took on afterwards and consider it more, rather than just saying yes to everything. But having said that, it's hard to know whether it went on for so long that there's sort of a response which isn't quite what it should be, and maybe we should be saying yes to everything. You know, it's hard to know, because the same opportunities are still not fully available in the way that they once were, because the human race isn't the same as it was before entirely. So what is circumstantial and what has changed internally, I don't know. I think it made, you know, it for me, obviously, the people that you love most in the world, how much you want to spend time with them, and appreciating the time we have with them, that's definitely a thing. Performing for people and the importance and the magic that that has is definitely something. I've always been pretty resourceful, and I kind of knew that that side of it would be okay. But my life is not the same as it was pre-pandemic, and I don't know if it is for many people, and how that will eventually change over time. None of us really know.
Was there a part of you doing these 250 concerts, which is an incredible number, was there a part of you that didn't want it to be over, and that the last one was quite pretty emotional?
It was emotional, the last one. I remember it really well. I sort of went outside, and by this time everyone was vaccinated, and they all had their glasses of wine. They were all, you know, everyone's in a good mood. The pandemic was kind of pretty much lifted. And I said, oh, so, you know, I'm going back to New York next week. And I had a sort of lump in my throat, even though I was so excited to go back. But just the sort of saying goodbye and bringing an end to this incredible, incredible time that they'd given me, really. So
it may have come to an end eventually, but we talk about the next part of the journey. Again, incredible. You're awarded a British Empire Medal in 2022 for your services to the community in West London. As we mentioned, these 250 concerts. What was your reaction when you heard that news? And second to that, what are your memories of the day and receiving that prestigious award?
You know, it was such a surprise and a miracle that I even found out in time, because the letter arrived to London and I had been in New York and was going to be for another 2 months. And it was only because my friend had come over to check the mail that she sent me a picture of this letter on Her Majesty's service. And then she said, would you like me to open it? And I said, yeah. And I was actually quite worried because I didn't know what it was. And then she said, and then she sort of sent me a picture of the letter. And I said, you know, would you accept this award? And had she not opened it, that I would never have been able to accept it, because you have to get back to them within a certain time. And I was standing in a deli ordering breakfast. And I was like, what? We had a concert celebrating it in New York on the night that it was announced, because again, I wasn't in the UK. And that was really fun. And then the investiture itself, I had friends come from New York who came to see it, and that was a really beautiful day. But I think, you know, the fact that it was Queen Elizabeth's last list was really poignant and special, given how long her reign was. But to have something to mark such an incredible time with these people that will remain friends, you know, there came so many concerts and we formed such a bond, is extremely special. Yeah.
A couple more questions left, but I'm going to change course again and talk about the recording process. And you've already mentioned about the release of your album, Heaven and Hell, The Doors of Perception, back in 2018.
Yeah.
What was the idea behind the album, and how did you find the recording process? And I also wanted you to talk about what Russ Tilterman brought to the table as a producer, and also talk about, we'll come on to talk about some of the collaborations on the album.
Yeah, it was the most organic process of an album imaginable, really. I had become friends with Russ because Barney Greengrass, which is a famous New York deli on the Upper West Side, where while I was auditioning to move to New York, so I was, I don't know, 19, I met a waiter there who came over to talk to me because I'd been sitting there for so long drinking coffee because I was trying to stay warm to audition because it was blizzards and snow outside and I wanted to keep my hands warm to play, and I'd been sitting there for hours. He came over and talked to me and asked me what I was doing, and I said, oh, you know, I'm just trying to stay warm before I go and play. And he said, oh, so you're planning to move to New York? And I said, yeah. And he's like, you'll make it. I can see it. You're going to get here. And I was like, I hope so. And then a year later, I went to see him. And he said, oh, I remember you. And he actually introduced me to another waiter there who owned an artist space. It was my very first job in New York. And his name's Julian Tepper. He's a well-known author and still runs a literary salon in New York. So I became a pianist there. And then he introduced me on the sort of Thursday boys brunch that they have, which is, you know, mostly film, actually. It's like Steven Spielberg and people like that. But Russ Titelman was at that brunch. And I'd been in to say hi to Julian. I was at a different table eating. And he said to Russ, do you know Harriet Stubbs? He said, no. And he said, well, you should really meet her, blah, 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 blah. So Russ left me his number on a Barney Greengrass receipt, which, like, I stuck up on my notice board at home. And I became friends with Russ. You know, I contacted him. We met for a milkshake. And then this milkshake sort of thing started to become a regular meeting. And it happened over a course of 2 years, really. And he would tell me all these stories about his life in the music industry. He's had quite an exciting life. And he eventually said, you know what, why don't we just go up to Jacob Burns Center in Pleasantville and just, I don't know, just do something together and see what happens. So we did. And it was a really fun day. I said, yeah, let's make an album. And, you know, I love your Blake stuff. Let's, you know, I don't want to do straight classical. I want, this will be my first classical album. I want to do something a bit different. And because he's, you know, his background is in pop and jazz. And so, you know, I said, well, why don't we make it about the Doors' perception, the Blakeyian journey? And that also kind of reflects with the Doors and rock and roll. And he said, well, I think we should really have some Blake on the album. So I curated different plates of Blake. And then we were in conversation with Patti Smith at one point. And then Marianne Faithfull became the person that just made total sense. You know, she has a love of Blake. She's a part of all the community of our friends and musicians. And that's how Marianne ended up being on it. And that's really, and then Russ and I, over the course of 2 years, a further 2 years, just would go into the recording studio and make a record of a piece. And then he'd say, you know, I think you should learn this. And I'd push back and say, no, I think we should do this. And, you know, and then eventually the album kind of came together, and what we felt really described that narrative that we believed in for the album. And you know, his take was from a totally non-biased classical take. It's from a love and a deep understanding of classical music, but not from a classical formal education, coming from just a love of music. And what he heard in it was so fresh and inspiring and different and informed by so many other different genres of music, that it just made for a really exciting collaboration. We had wonderful engineers, and we had a lot of fun making it. It was amazing.
Yeah, I want to ask you about the recording process, because it's a completely different discipline to recording live. And some recording artists relish in that process. And I've heard others say that they find it quite frustrating that the sound they want to produce sounds completely different on tape or, you know, on digital or whatever, when it's listened back. The process for you, did you enjoy that process working with an acclaimed producer? Did it all come sort of naturally? Was it quite easy in a sense?
It was easy. We were both coming at it with the best of intentions for the record. So, you know, there was nothing other than let's get the best music we possibly can involved. And, you know, with that setup, pushes me to be my best. And, you know, also learning something new and then recording it, rather than having a sort of year to create, to make and learn an album and then go and record it, is very different to kind of learning at speed in that way. So even though the process of recording was very long, the process of learning always felt very fast, and like there was no time. And sometimes I'd learn something and they'd say, actually, I've changed my mind. I'd be like, what? But in the end, you know, we always got the best results, and we listened to each other. And so I think so that the process of that record was beautiful, and the way it all came together was amazing. The record that I've just made, I did in the opposite fashion, not for any reason other than that made sense this time. Mike had said, you know, I booked us 2 days in LA to record. See you at the end of January. Have you figured out the rest of the album? And just did. And there was 2 days to do the entire album, which meant that it was basically a live album, because that's the time we had, and it had to be done in that time. And that in itself, as you said, is an entirely different discipline. And because it was in such a short period of time, I wanted to make it entirely unedited. So even when there was something which could have been changed with ease, I didn't do it, because I wanted to experiment with doing this process in the completely opposite way. As the circumstances were different, why not just do it exactly like that? So the record is exactly as it came out, with no editing, no anything of any kind.
This is kind of the question you probably never want to ask a creative, but when you sit down and listen back to those two albums, obviously one to be released, how do you kind of look back at them? Do you look back at them with sort of fondness, or is there part of you that says, oh, I wish I could have maybe done this differently, or this track I could have tampered or changed here, or this works better than this? Overall, would you say you're satisfied?
With the latest album, yes. Because it's been 5 years, and therefore 7 years really since I recorded the last album, you know, I listen to it now and I'm like, oh my god, you know, which, because we change. And I don't know, every new piece of work I do, I think the last piece of work I did was rubbish. Like, that's just what happens. You know, I can never listen to something once I've already done it, because it's like, oh no, I can't listen to it because this is much better. And I can't believe I thought that was good. You know, and that's always what it is for me. Even though the album, you know, objectively was quite good, it doesn't, you know, it feels so far removed from where my artistry is today. And I think that's true of a lot of people, but.
We shortly come on to those final questions, all will be revealed shortly. And I've got one final question to ask you. But at this point, we probably should plug the new album. And I'll ask, what's the title and when are we expected to hear it and when will it be released?
So it will be released September 14th. And at the moment, we are still working with the title. I do not have the title yet. The whole album is arrangements by Mike Garson, who was Bowie's collaborative pianist on Aladdin Sane. The Bowie arrangements are taken kind of from his live improvisations on stage with Bowie. But the other arrangements are all different, authentic parts of my career. So there's a Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds song on there, because, you know, he sort of was a spiritual part of how the album came to be, really. And I learned that arrangement in such a short period of time. It's become, maybe this week anyway, my favorite track on the album. And then there's arrangements of Bach, and there's a Chopin etude, which is sort of Chopin etude in one hand with another one in another hand, with an extra kind of, it's hard to describe, but it's technically one of the hardest things I've ever done. And to do that without any editing was a real kind of feat, but very exciting. And it was thrilling to do it. But it's all held together by Mike's kind of style of arranging. So yeah, we're very excited about the album. And, you know, I thought that we'd be doing it in 2020, but I couldn't get to LA, COVID. And actually, it all worked out exactly as it was meant to be, because the repertoire really came to make sense post-pandemic, right? Some of it having been played in the concert, some of it coming together because of things that had happened in life since then, and it wouldn't have been the same album. So it happened exactly when it was meant to.
You currently reside in London and New York. We've established that. What would you say are your interests away from music, and what do you like to do to relax when you get the chance? And what are your future musical plans, and would you like to work in any other creative areas outside of music?
So upcoming, so I'm performing in New York next week a couple of times, but yes, I plan to tour the album. Yesterday we just had kind of the beginnings of what that looks like come through, and I'll have a clearer idea by the end of the week. So in terms of my interests outside of music, I'm a dive master, so I enjoy doing free diving as well with orca in the Arctic, doing herring migration research and basking sharks in the Hebrides. But I also help rebuild coral reefs with the Central Caribbean Marine Institute in the Cayman Islands. And I'm the artistic director of a festival that we plan to finally have our first year after COVID in January, which is set in the ocean. And it's the first ever of its kind, and sort of combining all of those interests together. And then in academia, I'm hoping to be taking on a visiting professorship in the US to kind of further that side of my creativity and education. So an exciting time, I think, with all those disparate pieces coming together to create the next year.
Exciting times, lots of creative things. But have you ever wanted to do something outside of music per se? I don't know, venture into a documentary film or literature writing? Is there anything that kind of whets your appetite in another creative avenue?
I would I be interested in I don't know what talent I would have as a screenwriter, but if a collaboration came together that made sense, you know, I'd love to be involved in something like that. And I continue to write. And if that were to evolve into something else similar to the Blake Project, but different, then I would love to do that too. And I definitely think that gives me a whole different type of communication with the people that engage in my work too. So,
Harriet Stubbs, are you ready for this moment? This is the part where we ask all our guests the same quickfire 13 questions to wrap the interview. I think you're number 118.
Wow. Yeah,
so quite a few have answered these same questions. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, you don't need to think about these in any sort of depth. We just want to establish things maybe we've not found out in the last 60 or so minutes. What would you say, firstly, is your favourite pastime?
The ocean. Yeah. Outside of my career. Yeah.
One thing we haven't spoken about is film. What would you choose as your favourite film and why?
Changes all the time.
We'll let you pick a few because I could not pick one.
I loved Patti Smith's Dream of Life. It's still one that I kind of go back to, and it's been out for, I don't know, 10 years or so, but it's still one of my favourites. Clockwork Orange was a big part of, you know, teenage years, like many people. I loved Atonement too, thought that was beautiful. And I really love documentaries about artists. Like, I think that's one of my favorite things, as well as like stand-up comedy. That's kind of the combination that I really enjoy.
Clockwork Orange, I think, is a really interesting choice. So I'm going to pick up on that because I'm a huge Kubrick fan. I think I've seen that film about 8 or 9 times. A friend of mine who does all the caricatures for all the guests is absolutely obsessed with that film. I just think it's a tremendous film, very thought-provoking. But I also kind of feel, even now, it still has that impact. But I kind of even feel even now that it's a little bit still misunderstood. And that the controversy around it during its original release in 71, I kind of feel there's still a little bit of that stigma attached to it when I think it's got so more. It's more about rehabilitation and state control, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. And I think that an example of something which may come to have a similar legacy that's been released recently is Blonde, the Marilyn Monroe film, where it's had these narratives attached of it being misunderstood in many different ways. And I think it will take another 20 years for people to really understand where it was coming from. And it's similar in the way that it's extremely visually impactful. And that's kind of what made me think of it. And I think it's misunderstood for similar reasons, and will eventually kind of get to a place where it is understood for the sort of art form that it was.
And of course, it has that amazing classical score.
Yeah.
We go from Malcolm McDowell in A Clockwork Orange now to novels. But who, is your favourite novelist?
Well, I suppose because this is where I am at the moment, Mary Wollstonecraft, because I'm very involved in her, and now I'm reading Mary Shelley, and I got very involved with Mary because of the Blake piece, and she's kind of one of the invisible women. So right now I'm completely sort of wrapped up in Mary Wollstonecraft land. So I think that's where I am. Yeah.
Harriet, if you could have chosen a different profession, what would it have been?
Maybe something completely contrasting, like medicine.
Who next would you say has been the greatest inspiration in your life?
There are so many people that have formed who I've become. One that we haven't mentioned, perhaps, Cornel West, who is a good friend of mine, has been one of my sort of New York forces throughout my many years there, who has been someone to sort of politically and philosophically wrestle with about works of art, and he has a passion for classical music, and he's definitely one of my sort of formative figures as well.
We go on to newspapers next. Do you read a newspaper? And if so, what is your newspaper of choice?
New York Times.
What about a UK paper?
The Guardian.
From newspapers to food, what would you say, Harriet, is your favourite food?
Scallops.
From food to cultural icons, we ask all our guests to name a favourite cultural icon. Could be someone from history, could be someone past or present. Somebody who's changed the course of our lives, the way we live in medicine or technology, an inventor. Who would you choose as your favourite cultural icon?
Obviously, there are many. But I think one of my favourites is Patti Smith. I think Just Kids was groundbreaking, but her story of truly evolving into the thing she was meant to be despite all odds is so inspiring and creatively energizing for whatever we are pursuing in life. And I think that's what cultural icons are kind of meant to do, right? So
cultural icons to curse words. What would you say is your favorite curse word and why?
Fuck. I think fuck I use the most. Yeah.
A lot of people choose that word. It seems to be a common theme. From curse words now to favourite places or holiday destinations, which one's your favourite or favourites?
The Arctic's my favourite. It was my favourite of all. I love many places in the world, but yeah.
A question I don't particularly want to ask you, because I imagine there's so many favourites in music, but who would you cite as your favourite music artist? And what is your favourite album?
Recently, Apple Classical, which is the brand new sort of classical music experience app, which is the metadata is very sophisticated and it's very exciting for classical music. They've just released this volumes of Martha Argerich Live, and that's right now giving me life. And I'm going to be lost in that for a very long time. So I think that's currently my musical world at the moment.
And the final two, Harriet. Firstly, what would you say is your greatest achievement to date?
I think the industry showcase of my first album, because it was the culmination of all of my years of work, so 20 years of work to that date. It was the day that really defined the transition into the next phase of my career, and it was filled with the people I loved most in the world, and it was a day where I finally felt like I'd met that threshold of the next stage of my life, and it was thrilling and amazing. There've been lots of days that are amazing, but that one, I think, just defined a transition to the next phase.
And finally, Harriet Stubbs, how do you wish to be remembered?
I hope to have helped to nurture a durable and lasting young audience for classical music, and to inspire other people to be involved in music and have music in their lives. I don't think it's important whether they pursue it or not. I don't think that's the point at all, but for them to have it as a tool in their life in whatever capacity that is, I think that's really important thing to give.
It's a nice way to end the interview. Harriet Stubbs, thank you kindly for taking part on today's Your Take. Feel very honoured to have you as a guest. And it's just been an incredible story, this musical journey that starts very, very young. And, you know, long may it continue. And it'd be interesting to see the different courses it goes off in and the different things you pursue and do for the remainder of your career. But thanks very much for sharing all the things you've done. It really has been incredible to hear.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks a lot. And looking forward to hearing the new album for September, as you mentioned. And thanks for your support. And one thing that's been very nice leading up to this interview, whenever I post something on Instagram, I always see, oh, Harriet Stubbs has seen that. So that's been quite nice to see that you've been following our progress. So thank you very much for taking part.
Of course. I mean, 118 interviews, quite a feat.
It's quite a few, to be honest. Yeah. Not quite 250, but maybe you will get there. Who knows?
You certainly will. I mean, you got that far.
Just another, 102? No, what? Oh, I can't even do my maths.
Yeah. Oh, fine. You're almost halfway.
This is why I was bottom of the class at maths, see? I couldn't even work that out. Okay, thanks a lot, and I wish you all the very best.
Thank you, Angie.